two Thanksgiving dinners, so I forgot to wear my 2 days after Thanksgiving pants. I didn't think sweatpants would be appropriate for church, so. So this morning, I wanted to read from Colossians chapter 3 about the resurrected life. I'm just talking, it's all right. Colossians chapter 3, I'm just going to read the chapter of the Message Bible. So if you're serious about living this new resurrection life with Christ, act like it. Pursue the things over which Christ presides. Don't shuffle along, eyes to the ground, absorbed with the things right in front of you. Look up and be on alert to what is going on around Christ. That's where the action is. See things from his perspective. Your old life is dead. Your new life, which is your real life, even though it's invisible to spectators, is with Christ in God. He is your life. When Christ, your real life, remember, shows up again on this earth, you'll show up too, the real you, the glorious you. Meanwhile, be content with obscurity like Christ. And that means killing off everything connected with the way of death. Sexual promiscuity, impurity, lust, doing whatever you feel like, whenever you feel like it, and grabbing whatever attracts your fancy. That's a life shaped by things and feelings instead of a life shaped by God. It's because of this kind of thing that God is about to explode in anger. It wasn't long ago that you were doing all that stuff and not knowing any better. But you know better now, so make sure it's all gone for good. Bad temper, irritability, meanness, profanity, dirty talk. And don't lie to one another. You're done with that old life. It's like a filthy set of ill-fitting clothes you've stripped off and put in the fire. Now you're dressed in a new wardrobe. Every item of your new wardrobe is a way of life. It's custom made by the Creator with his label on it. For all the shoppers in the room, I like that analogy. All the old fashions are now obsolete. Words like Jewish and non-Jewish, religious and irreligious, insider and outsider, uncivilized and uncouth, slave and free mean nothing. From now on, everyone is defined by Christ. Everyone is included in Christ. So chosen by God for this new life of love, dress in the wardrobe God has picked out for you. Dress in compassion, kindness, humility, quiet strength and discipline. Be even-tempered, content with second place, quick to forgive an offense. Forgive as quickly and completely as the Master forgave you. And regardless of what else you put on, wear love. It's your basic all-purpose garment. Never be without it. Let the peace of Christ keep you in tune with each other, in step with each other. None of this going off and doing your own thing. And cultivate thankfulness. Let the word of Christ, the message, have the run of the house. Give it plenty of room in your lives. Instruct and direct one another using good common sense. And sing your hearts out to God. Let every detail in your lives, words, actions, whatever, be done in the name of the Master, Jesus, thanking God the Father every step of the way. So a couple of things that stood out. I love the analogy of garments, right? I always think of, we're supposed to put on the righteousness of Christ like a garment, like a robe. And we're also supposed to wear all of the attributes of the Spirit, love and peace. Those are our garments. And when we carry those wherever we go, it's so much easier to not get ruffled, right? Because this world likes to ruffle us up and make us forget who we are. And makes us want to put on the old, dirty, smelly clothes and be irritable and be unkind and uncharitable. And I'm telling you, if there's ever been an environment where people are uncharitable and ruffled, it's been the last month. And if we can just rise above it and be the love of Christ, there is no Democrat, there is no Republican. Those are old things. And we are simply love in Christ. And when we can be love, we can be an example that people will go, were we just talking about politics? How did we get to Jesus? Yeah. Jesus is everything. Yes. He is the King. Every knee will bow, every tongue will confess. It does not matter who's in the White House. It does not matter. But it matters how we portray him, right? Right. We're examples. Right. And people look, right? And so I say this morning that we choose love, that we choose to put on those garments and put off the old. And I'm looking forward to singing my heart out. Singing my heart out to the Lord, because that helps put things in perspective. It helps us remember how wonderful he is. Wow. And he fills this place with his presence. Wow. And he loves on us. And we can just pour our hearts out back to him. And then it's so much easier to love.
Amen.
When our hearts are tender from being in his presence, because he is love.
Yes.
He is love.
Yes.
And he will always lead us and guide us in all righteousness, in Jesus'
Amen.
Name.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Anybody have any? Yeah, pray. Yeah, Don.
It's remarkable that you brought this all up, because I was telling Jane the other night, I was laying in bed. In the middle of the night, I wrestled with all these things. And I was thinking about all of my shortcomings, which I don't know if anybody else does, but I do constantly,
yeah.
Which are many.
Right, absolutely.
And I thought, you know, Lord, forgive me again. I know this, that, and everything that said, you think, okay, that's what I want to strive to do.
Right.
And the gist of the whole conversation I began to have with the Lord that I never saw, maybe others have, is that I have always wanted, I told Jane, I said, what a thrill it would be to be able to stand in front of the Lord and say, I have never done anything wrong. I have done everything. And it came to me that in the very trying to attain those things, I am establishing my own righteousness. I want to do it for me,
right.
Not for him.
Right.
I want to be able to stand there and say, I've never done this, I've never done that, so that I can just stand there and say, look at me.
Yeah.
I did it. Mm-hmm. And that's it. And the Lord said, righteousness, the righteousness that he wants,
mm-hmm.
cannot be earned. It must be imparted.
Yeah.
Yes. He imparts
yeah.
righteousness in spite of all my failures.
Yeah, right. Yes.
And that's, again, it's the that world and this world colliding.
Yeah.
Because in this world, anything we want to attain, we got to work our tails off to get.
Mm-hmm.
It's ingrained in us.
Mm-hmm.
And to understand that not only does he impart righteousness, he's the justifier.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
He said, what he says is, if he justifies you,
mm-hmm.
then I'll tell you what, we are our own
yes.
biggest enemy.
Oh, yes.
We
oh,
worry about the devil.
Absolutely.
I see why you don't see very much about the devil in the New Testament. I mean, like, he doesn't stay on there, chase them down and all that. No. They realized they were the ones that they had to deal with.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's our minds that...
Right.
And I'm not, of course the devil puts thoughts and things in, but he can only feed what we already have
right.
an appetite for.
Right.
And we seek to please God, but we seek to do it. I'm being honest. I had to realize, yeah, you're right, Lord.
Yeah.
I guess I really want to be righteous for my sake.
Right.
I want to be able to say, I did it. I didn't do this. I fought against that. This temptation came and I overcame it because
right.
of what? Because I willed it.
Mm-hmm.
And then I wonder why a failure. Well, why I failed is because I don't have a will that strong.
Mm-hmm.
I have temptations that I run headlong into.
Mm-hmm.
And I just think, then I see in the 7th chapter of Romans what Paul meant.
Mm-hmm.
A wretched man that I am.
Right.
Who can save me from myself? It's just fantastic, though, that, you know, and I'm not saying that just gives us a license, again, to go out and do everything we want to do. And I think any time we do something that does not live up to the level that we have been taught, this
right.
is where you should be, it bothers us.
Right.
But we can't let it destroy us.
Right.
Because there's a point you could just throw in the towel
yeah.
and say, I
yeah.
never achieve what I'm trying to
mm-hmm.
achieve, yeah. And I think you better, the quicker you throw in that towel and say, Lord, just
Amen.
Your grace, your mercy. That's
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
That's all that's going to get me
mm-hmm.
through.
Yep.
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 Amen.
Amen.
And I'll be honest, every time I'm led to a scripture that talks about this or that or right or wrong or do this, I hesitate to read it because the old man does.
Yeah.
The resurrected life just is.
Yeah.
It just is.
Yeah.
Not because of anything I have or have not done. And there's a song about so much grace, so much grace, so much grace. I can't earn it. I can't do anything that to make him love me less, and I can't do anything to make him love me more. It just is.
Yes.
And so when I read a scripture like that, it doesn't daunt me. It doesn't make me feel guilty, because my old man is nothing but guilt and shame, because that old man is going to do nothing but put on those stinking rotten clothes and want to rock around and be stinking and rotten.
Yeah.
Every day, that's the battle. But the discipline and the things that they talked about were to choose to cast off the old. Every time I go to put it on, to cast it off and just keep going.
Yeah.
That's the battle, is to keep going.
Yeah.
And to know that he loves us no less.
Right.
He loves us no less.
Right.
But we have to get up and keep going, and we have to keep coming together, and we have to keep
singing
our hearts out.
Yes.
That just really struck me this morning about singing our hearts out. This is a season where caroling and singing really kind of comes to the forefront, and all the good holiday music.
Right.
Oh, let's just sing our hearts out.
Yes.
And just let everything else go. Just let it go.
Amen.
Let the Lord do the laundry.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Anybody else this morning? Any prayer requests or any testimonies? Anybody? Yeah.
I'd like prayer for my sister-in-law.
Okay. What's her name? What's her name, Carol? What's her name?
Mary.
Mary, thank you. Mary, we'll pray for Mary. Anybody else? Diane. Sister Pam. She had open heart surgery early this year and has had a prolonged side effect where she's suffering from severe depression and anxiety, where she's on short-term disability from work. I guess that's not an uncommon side effect, but I think for her it's very spiritual. It's a very spiritual attack. I don't know if anybody knows my story, but she's my birth mother. She's my natural mother. And so I believe that she's as spiritually sensitive as I am. She just doesn't understand it as much. She is a believer. She does read her devotional every day, and that's what gives her sanity right now. But I'm just believing that whatever this attack is gone without medication, without all the stuff that they're trying to pump into her, in Jesus' name.
Right.
Amen.
Yes, Lord.
So anybody else this morning, any needs or prayer requests? All right, well, let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, we ask that you touch Mary this morning, wherever she is, Lord.
You are the healer. We know, God, that you have lifted her
up from this morning. Pray for Jeff this morning, Lord, that you would touch his heart, Lord, his natural heart and his spiritual heart, Lord. His eyes would be open, Lord.
All old things have passed away. We thank you, God. Keep our eyes open. We are who we have in us.
Lift that pan this morning.
We look to you,
Lord. Lift that veil. Lift that veil of depression and anxiety, Lord, that you would break through. Your righteousness with your grace and mercy with your goodness.
Thank you, Lord, for your truth.
I thank you, Lord, that the old man is cast away. I thank you that we cast off old man like dirty garments, Lord. And we put our hope and our trust in you. That we walk boldly in the resurrected life, Lord, that you have given us. The free gift, Lord, that you have imparted to everyone who has put their hope and their trust in you. That we put on your righteousness like a robe, Lord. We wear love and kindness like a garment. And as we gather together, Lord, this morning, we sing our hearts out to you. We lift up your name, the name above all names, Jesus. As we celebrate this season, Lord, of your triumphant entry, your humble entry into this world, Lord, where you changed the ending. You changed the story forever, Lord. You came and humbled yourself and came as a man and walked among us, Lord. And you conquered death, hell, and the grave, but you conquered so much more than that. You opened the way before us to walk in love, to walk in the power of your Holy Spirit, Lord. And you chose from that day. the season is changing.
Thank you, God.
And that although we're ending the fall, the harvest is just beginning. That we are entering a season of harvest, a season of fruit for the seeds that have been sown, a season of yes and amen. For those who will believe, for those who will believe in spite of what they see. Yes and amen. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Reminder, if you brought your cell phone with you, to turn the ringer off or turn it off this morning. And Eastern Gate House of Prayer, my favorite Friday night of the month.
Focusing on the reason for the season.
And for anybody that hasn't been in, come, we are doing communion each Friday night when we come for Eastern Gate House Prayer, and it's really been very special, and I believe that there is a lot of healing that's happening through the communion. It's been amazing, so if you can come even for just a few minutes, I really encourage you to participate. It's wonderful what the Lord's doing. And let's speak the word this morning.
Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law.
Hallelujah. Yeah. Turn it off.
Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. To prove that this morning, we're going to have prayer here. Don, if you would like to just step forward and tell us what the situation is, and we're going to respond in Jesus' name.
Our granddaughter, Reagan, that's Andy's daughter, has been diagnosed with something. It's a 200 beats a minute heart rate, and they want to go in and burn the nerve. They call it a simple procedure.
Sure.
But we want Reagan to realize that the reason we're all gathered here is because there is a Creator.
Yes.
And He can fix her.
That's right.
And He would love to prove to you that He is everything He said.
Amen. Amen.
So we just, right, if you come up here, and anybody that can and will, we want her not only to be healed, but we want Jesus so embedded and buried in her very being that she'll never forget it. She'll never be the same again. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Amen, amen. Hallelujah. Thank the Lord, thank the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God, praise God. Hallelujah. Let's just do that again. Thank you, Jesus, for healing Reagan. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Lord, you alone, hallelujah, are worthy. You are the great physician. There is none like you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you for your perfect work in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise God. Thank you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Suzanne, for your opening remarks, and thank you, Don, for sharing. And it's right in line with what I want to talk about this morning. And I'm just so grateful to the Holy Spirit and what we've already felt here this morning. And whether we felt it or not, He's here. And He's real. He's more real than anything we can see. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And I thank all of you for sharing your prayer requests. And you just stand on it, on the Word of God, and declare it to be the reality. Praise God.
Yes,
and God will make it so.
Hallelujah. Yes.
In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Mike, I want to start in Romans chapter 8. Romans 8 and verses 9 and 10.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. Praise the Lord. Well, I'd know if I was turned on, but I don't know if the thing was turned on there. Praise God. Madness takes its toll. So please have exact change. Hallelujah. Well, we're all stuffed after Thanksgiving, and it was a great holiday, and had a good time with family. But I learned something. How to cut carbs.
slice the pizza.
Yeah. That's right. Amen.
Praise the Lord. So write that down when you're next time you're thinking about your weight issues, and that'll be a great blessing for you. I'm not random. You just can't think as fast as I can. All right, praise the Lord. It's just conflict of no interest. All right, Romans 8, verses 9 and 10. You're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. Thank the Lord. So, if you're looking for the weakness in us as the church in exercising our authority, look to the source of that problem. It's a failure to grasp the truth of Christ in you in a way that will destroy the illusion of this sense of separation. Or knowing God only at a distance. Satan, the scripture says, is the accuser of the brethren. So he's constantly challenging our identity, the same as he did Jesus in the wilderness. You'll find some parallels here between us and Jesus. I hope you do. Because what I'm saying may seem almost blasphemous, but it was thought blasphemous of Jesus to say the same thing.
Right.
So I'm only saying what the Lord said.
Yeah.
I'm only saying what my Father says. Praise God. And the transforming truth is our inward fusion with Him. That's what changes you,
yes.
Knowing that you are one with God.
Yes.
He that is joined to the Lord is one spirit.
Yes.
Not a bunch of spirits, but one spirit. And we have His mind, the scripture tells us. We have His power. All power is given unto Him.
Yes.
He said, go ye therefore.
Yes.
Greater works than these shall you do.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And if all power is given to Him, then all power is in us.
Yes.
And that's why we can confidently pray for anybody in any situation,
yes,
or any circumstance.
Yes.
Because we have all the power resident in us.
Yes.
Praise God. Glory. Hebrews 11 and verse 3. Hebrews 11 and 3. Well, we look at things that are not, you know. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. Amen. Framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. In other words, the visible is made out of the invisible. So we are at the very center. Hallelujah. You can't see Jesus in me, not in the person. But that's what I'm saying. We are at the very center and the source of everything. Of all things. Nothing existed except by Him. They are all invisible before He spoke them into existence. The reality of what we call reality, what we see, is invisible in the initial, in the birthing of it.
Yes.
It's invisible. We look at things that are, and we let them dictate to us. When the fact is they wouldn't exist if there wasn't something in the invisible that made them come into the visibility.
Yes.
Amen. So if we see a blind eye and a withered hand, we're dominated by the visible.
Right.
And we don't bridge the gap in us,
right,
between our thoughts and God's word of faith.
Yes.
Yeah.
And God's reality. Our,
yes,
our natural soulish way of thinking and the true wisdom of God that is in us, Christ in us, the hope of glory. Jesus saw the will and the power of the Father to heal, and He spoke the word,
yes,
which is what we have just done this morning, and we did it when we were praying for these other needs.
Yes.
Jesus saw the same thing, the blind man, and He said, receive your sight.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He saw the man with the withered hand, He just said, stretch forth your hand.
Yeah.
We see the withered hand. We're confounded by the withered hand. We're confounded by the blinded eye. Jesus wasn't. He just said, see, receive your sight, stretch forth your hand. We see a few loaves and fish. We see lack. We see not enough. Jesus saw the Father's unlimited visible supply, invisible supply, and He gave thanks.
Yes.
He gave thanks for what He couldn't see, because He knew what was coming was invisible first before it could ever be visible.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
We need to understand Everything that is in this world comes from the invisible first. It has to be there before it can be here. We have an invisible reality in us. In order for that reality to become visible, we have to speak it into existence. We have to know who we are, what we are in Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 7. I want to show you a declaration from God. Not just some idle talk, but he was declaring something. We have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not our flesh. It's us because God is in us. The excellency of this power is invisible. What you see isn't what you get. What you see is not what you want. What you see is invisible that can become visible.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
So God's declaration, a treasure in earthen vessels. Just like God in Christ, you can't strip the human veneer off of Christ. Not when he was here in the flesh.
Right.
You couldn't do that so that you could reveal the inner man or the inner substance. Mm-hmm. And so we can't strip away our humanity.
Right.
But it's the thing that haunts us and tries to get us to look at it, as was spoken of already here this morning, so that we don't see the reality.
Yep.
We're seeing something that is not real.
Right.
What is real, we can't see.
Right.
But we have to look at it as though it were.
Yes.
That's how God works.
Yes.
And God in us works the same way.
Right.
He doesn't change his agenda simply because he's in a human being. Jesus proved that.
Yes.
Right.
That was it.
At the same time, we have this truth from God. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8. We need to really look at this word of God and believe it, for crying out loud. Instead of using it as just a talking point for a sermon or a feel-good moment, recognize this is our reality. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. If he couldn't do that, he wouldn't ask you to. You can because you have Christ in you.
Yes.
Who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. Now, you can get all freaked out about that, but the truth is, if we've got all the fullness of the Godhead in us, which is what the Bible tells us, then we are equal with God. I'm not saying we're God. I'm saying we have equal standing with God. He's made us righteous so we can have that, so that we can operate in the power of the Spirit, of the invisible.
Yes.
Amen.
But made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. That's where we are. He was a man. He was made in the likeness of men. He was made like us. That's a parallel of us. Being found in the fashion as a man, he humbled himself, became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross.
Yes.
Paul said we were crucified with Christ. Yet we live, but it's not us that lives anymore. It's Christ in us that lives. It's the Spirit of God living in us. Praise the Lord. So there's this incarnation in all of us. Not just in Jesus. Jesus was the firstborn of many brethren. We have that same incarnation.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Praise God. We were crucified. And now we live to God. God doesn't see this. We see this. We focus on this. We let our own conscience, our minds. See, we were given a personality, the same personality that God has. But our personality wants to dominate.
Yeah.
It's only when we yield our personality to his personality that we're able to overcome.
Right.
Just another way of saying what I just said. Look at 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 5. 1 Peter 1, 3 through 5. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible, undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. Let me just remind you that reserved in heaven isn't talking about when we get to Never Never Land. It's talking about in the spirit realm.
Yes.
You are spirits. You now have this. You don't have it until you die. Who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time or the last days. How many of you know these are the last days? They were the last days when he wrote that.
Yeah.
It's about us revealing this reality, this incarnation of God in us, the way Jesus did the same thing.
Right. Jesus.
It's the human vessel that carries the treasure of God's revelation to the world. In any way, however that is, either through words, through prayer for people, through casting out demons, and all the things that we talk about every service, but when we read the word. Right. Think about it. Without the vessel, there wouldn't be a treasure. That's why Jesus came in the flesh.
Yes.
Because the treasure needed a vehicle.
Yes. Right.
Amen.
Without us, there's no treasure.
Right.
God made it that way. That isn't us. Religion didn't decide this. God decided this.
Right.
John 10, verse 30. We're talking about boldness. We just that if we understand this, if we really get this down, boldness is not a problem.
Right.
It's just natural for us to do the supernatural.
Right.
That's who we are.
Exactly.
I and my Father are one.
Right.
Praise God.
Yes.
Jesus spoke with the authority of God. He claimed God's power. He claimed his ability to forgive sins. Look at this. John 20, verse 21 through 23. John 20, 21 through 23. Then said Jesus to them again, "Peace be unto you, as my Father has sent me, even so send I you."
Right.
No difference.
Exactly.
And when he had said this, he breathed on them and saith unto them, "Receive you the Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins, you remit." Has that ever bothered you? That scripture? It shouldn't, because you've got the same authority that Jesus had in this earth. You have God in you. You and your Father are one. You need to know it. You need to speak it. You need to live your life that way, the way Jesus lived his life. I'm not talking about perfection without any moral flaws. I'm talking about living in the power of the Spirit, operating by your true identity. And whosoever sins and retain, they're retained. Think of the authority, the confidence that God has in you.
Yes.
Why? Because it's Christ in you, the hope of glory. Because you and he are one. You have one personality if you just recognize it.
Yes.
Jesus, okay, you say, well, yeah, but come on, I got to pray. Well, Jesus regularly prayed to the Father.
Oh, yes.
He spoke about the Father as somebody other than himself. Yet we know that the Father and him are one.
Yes.
So we get conflicted because we think, well, I got to pray a prayer. I got to do this and I got to do that, which makes God way off in the distance. Jesus never saw it that way.
No.
Neither should you. He just had conversations with
yes.
himself.
Yes.
That's what you're doing. You have God in
yes.
you. I'm not saying you shouldn't, you know, you shouldn't bow to the glory and the power of God, but I'm saying that's your flesh that's doing it. Because when all things wrap up, we're going back to where we came from, and that's back to God. We're going to be one with him for eternity. He tells us that we already are. It's just this thing, this earth suit, this physical body that we have that alienates us from God. Jesus overcame it.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. The day of Pentecost, God pours out his Spirit. God no longer is hovering over people or just touching them and moving upon them. He literally comes into
yes.
them and lives with them and becomes one.
Yes.
When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and set upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. We
yes.
talked about, I think it was Don that spoke about how, you know, how the early church got, you know, beyond this, the focus that we have about us.
Yeah.
How? From then on, from that moment on, Christians knew that God was not only out there, but also
yes.
inside of them, that they were one with God, that they
yes.
were not separate from God. They were no longer just religiously going through things to get God's approval. God had literally made them righteous. The reason for righteousness is so that we can be in the presence of God.
Yes.
Romans chapter 8, verses 9 through 11. I mean, we need this because we've got people that are sick.
Yeah.
We go through stuff that we shouldn't be going through.
Yes.
I'm not picking on anybody. I'm not blaming anybody. I'm just saying,
right.
we need to take authority.
Yes.
We need to know who we are and speak the way that we that we can through the authority that we have as earthen vessels filled with this treasure of God, the kingdom of God. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit, he's none of his. And Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin. That's how God sees us. That's how we ought to see ourselves. This thing is just, it's just something for marketing so that they can get us to buy clothes and food. So, I mean, that's all it's about. It's all about this realm. It's all about this world.
Yes.
And if Christ be in you, the body's dead because of sin. But the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you.
Yes.
The day will come when this thing won't mean anything. It'll be just like the Spirit.
Yes.
Right now, it's an obstacle. Then it'll be an asset.
Yeah.
So we have to look at it as something that is just temporary.
Yes.
It's not real. The invisible is what's real.
Yes.
Humans, us. We experience a God who created the world, whose glory is still revealed, still reflected in the wonder of the creation. We see it every changing of seasons. We see it at the beach. We see it in the mountains. We see it everywhere.
Yes.
Whose love and power could be seen in the human face of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
A God who personally is present and active in our lives.
Yes.
Revealed in earthen vessels.
Yes.
Mark chapter 8, verse 35. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. Simply put, we deny the flesh. This body.
Yes.
We deny the vessel and declare the Spirit. The church has had us for centuries focusing on the flesh. Not denying it. Maybe trying to beat it up, but not denying it. Trying to make it the focus. When it never was. Not from the very beginning. Just pay no attention to it. It's the Wizard of Oz, you know. Don't pay attention to the little guy behind the screen. You know? Pay attention to the invisible.
Yes. Yes.
Don't worry about the visible.
Right.
1 John chapter 4, verses 17 and 18. 1 John 4, 17 and 18. I'm excited because these are the last days.
Yes.
And we have a promise from God that we're going to see it again. The reason the book of Acts is the book of Acts is because those people got it.
Amen.
And we've been trying to get it again for the last 2,000 years.
Yeah.
Herein is our love made perfect. This was last week, remember? It was talking about love and fear. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear has torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. So there's two things that are going to happen to every one of us. Well, I assume, but, you know, maybe the rapture. But, you know, barring that, we're all going to die, and we're all going to stand before God.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And the only difference between us and the unsaved is we'll stand there with no fear.
Right.
Exactly.
Because we've been declared righteous.
Yes.
Amen.
We don't have to give an account for our lives. It's already been accounted to Jesus, and his life has been accounted to us. So death has no sting to us, because we'll stand before God accepted in the beloved. Why? Because he and I are one. He can't deny himself, it says. The scripture says it itself. He cannot deny himself. When I'm standing before him, he's going to see a reflection of him. I'm talking about in the Spirit. That's how he sees us right now. Death doesn't mean anything to God, because the only thing that's dying is the vessel. The treasure's going back to where it came from.
Yes. Yes. Oh, Lord. Yes, yes, yes.
Let that truth get into you. Let it just sink into your bloodstream, into your DNA, and captivate your imagination. And the specifics will come.
Yes, they will.
The things you need to do will happen because God will speak to you.
Yes.
He'll direct your steps. Yes. If you recognize who you are, you won't be timid. You won't be ashamed to step out. And lay hands on the sick and see him recover and do the things that you need to do, because you won't be looking at your last failure. You'll be looking at the one success that determines your identity and your reality.
Yes.
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 Yes, that's it.
Romans chapter 16, verses 25 and 26. Romans 16, verses 25 and 26. Now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret until the world began, but now is made manifest, and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith. Humans and divine mystery merge. Mm-hmm. You know what a coincidence is? It's coincidences. It's incidents. It's things that happen. They come together. They're the same.
Right.
And we call it deja vu or whatever, right? But Jesus pushed back the horizons of human mystery so that they open onto the divine mystery. Does that make sense?
Yes.
He made God and man one again.
Mm-hmm.
For those who could believe.
Yes.
Amen.
We were created in the image of God.
Yes.
Born again from above. Children of God. So we have absolutely no grounds at all for assuming one excludes the other.
Right.
It cannot not and be faithful to the Word of God. John 14, verses 10 through 18. See, religion has made us so paranoid that we don't even want to identify with God for fear of being a hypocrite or somebody's going to find out I didn't do this perfectly. And that. Look, you don't have to dig very deep in my history, even yesterday or 20 minutes ago, to find that I'm flawed. But I have this treasure in this flawed vessel.
Yes.
I got a little thing on my desk back there that says, God's all right with cracked vessels because they let out the light.
Mm, come on.
They let out the glory. He's all right with us being cracked and not perfect and marred because it lets him out.
Yes.
It shows that we're dependent on his grace and not on this vessel.
Yes.
Believest thou not that I'm in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake.
Yes.
Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he also do, or do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go to my Father. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son.
Yep.
If ye ask anything in my name, I'll do it.
Yep.
If you love me, keep my commandments. What's his commandment? To love. And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another comforter that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it seeth him not. He's invisible. Neither knoweth him, but you know him, because he dwells with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. That's God speaking. You can call him whatever you want to call him. You can call him Jesus. You can call him the Holy Spirit, but it's God. Jesus was God in the flesh. The Holy Spirit is God's Spirit.
Yes.
Christ in you, the hope of glory. It's not a bunch of mixed up, confused adjectives here. They're one.
Right.
Yes.
And we have become one with him.
Yes.
You're going to live eternity connected to God by the Spirit. I'm not talking about you won't have a separate identity as a human. Living forever, Jesus still standing in heaven as the man that was down here on earth with a glorified body. He has an independent reality, but he's one with the Father.
Yes.
And we will be the same way.
Yes.
In fact, we are right now. He just knew it, and we're still trying to figure it out.
Yes.
Come on.
Yes.
Living in eternity.
all God's will and my will. Do you think they're mutually exclusive? Or what if they coexist? What if they're one and the same? What I'm saying is, the opposite of a correct statement is a false statement. But according to the scripture and what I'm seeing, the opposite of a profound truth may be another profound truth.
Come on.
As God is in me. That's what Jesus said. Christ, He is in you. We see the profound truth of that statement about Jesus, and then when it comes to us, we can't make them coalesce. But the truth is, that profound statement about Jesus, as profound as it is, man filled with God on this earth, God coming in the flesh, is simply a profound truth that is then the opposite, or would be a contradiction if it was just us. But that profound truth leads to another profound truth. It's not a true statement and a false statement. It's one profound truth that leads to another profound truth, and that is Christ in you, the hope of glory. This treasure in earthen vessels, and that's the point that God is trying to get across all throughout the New Testament.
Yes.
And we've made it about everything else, but the one thing that will save a dying world, that will change the lives of everybody we come into contact, the way Jesus change people's lives.
Yes.
Mark chapter 1, verse 15. What Jesus was saying, as God is in me, so He is in you. Not some lesser God, not a little bit less or less power or less. Exactly the same.
Yes.
Anything less than that would be a false statement. And saying the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. Now, the gospel. What's the gospel? The good news.
Yes.
God has come.
Yes.
He isn't announcing getting forgiven. He's not even announcing eternal life or salvation or heaven. He's announcing that He's bringing the kingdom of God or God's reign back to this planet.
Yes.
Amen. Again. That's why we're still here. That's why the body of Christ is still here. That's why it calls it a body.
Yes.
Because in it inhabits God.
Right.
Or I should say, God inhabits it.
Yeah.
The kingdom is in you.
Yes.
Romans chapter 5, verse 17. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one Jesus Christ. It's not like I get to rule over everybody now. God gets to rule again in me the way it did in Jesus. The kingdom has come. It's coming in me. It's coming in you. It's coming wherever you go the way Jesus went, the kingdom comes.
Yes.
Look at this. Isaiah 61, verses 1 and 2. It's the same thing. This is where Jesus quotes this in Luke chapter 4 and verse 16 through, I think, 30 or whatever it is. He's quoting this very thing. He said, this day, this word is fulfilled before your very eyes.
Right.
And here's what he was talking about. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn. His conclusion, as I said, is in Luke, where he says, today, this scripture is fulfilled. Mm. All of creation started out very good, God said, but came under the tyranny of Satan. Now look at John chapter 20, verse 21. Then said Jesus to them again, peace be unto you, as my Father has sent me, even so send I you.
Yes.
Same, identical.
Yes.
Whenever Jesus heals, the kingdom comes.
Yes.
whenever he reaches out to love the leper or the tax collector or the prostitute, the kingdom comes. Person by person, piece by piece, he's reclaiming a territory that has been held by Satan. That's what we're doing. That's what we do. And we're praying for God to come and do something. God has already come and done something. Now it's up to us to step out in faith and declare what Jesus declared. This day, this prophecy, this word of God is fulfilled in your presence before your very eyes.
Come on.
Amen. I mean, that's a bold statement. That is profound. But it's true. And we got to get over our sense of we got to be meek and all this stuff. I'm not saying we shouldn't be arrogant and stupid, but at the same time, we ought to recognize that it's not arrogant when you're just telling the truth.
Right.
It's not being stupid and ignorant if you're just declaring the reality that God has already declared himself.
Amen.
Revelation chapter 11, verse 15. And the seventh angel sounded, and there was a great voice in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. How does he do that? Through us, because we're going to be back on this earth reigning in his place, in the person of God. Amen? Everything. Everything. Right now, it's wherever we go. Understanding this truth, wherever we go, we take the kingdom of God is prevailing. This scripture is becoming a reality today. It doesn't have to happen. It doesn't have to wait until after the tribulation and flying Volkswagens and all the rest of the stuff that we're worried about, bugs in the air and whatever other diseases and all that kind of horrible stuff that we may or may not experience. The reality is we're making this world's kingdoms the kingdom of God again. And it doesn't come through an election. It doesn't come through the death and the birth of another king or queen or some tyrant rising to power. We know that's all going to come to an end.
Yes.
Uh-huh. And we can enforce that reality today.
Yes.
Regardless of who's in the White House or who's on the throne in England or who's running some Middle East nightmare. Kingdom, the scripture says, doesn't come by observation. So you don't see the kingdom coming down the street when you see me. But it's coming.
Mm-hmm.
It just doesn't come by observation. It doesn't come by the vessel. It isn't identified by the vessel, I should say.
Right.
It's identified by the treasure that's in that vessel.
Right.
Now look at Matthew chapter 13, verse 31 and 32. And here Jesus has given us a kind of a metaphor for this truth that I'm talking about today. The kingdom, not coming by observation. He tells us a parable he put forth unto them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like a grain of a mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in his field, which indeed is the least of all seeds. It's insignificant. Tiny. Almost invisible. But when it's grown, it's the greatest among herbs and becometh a tree, so that the birds of the air come and lodge in the branches thereof. Insignificant to the human eye. Looks weak. Looks insignificant. But it will expand to every corner of God's creation. That's this treasure in earthen vessels.
Right.
So again, the opposite of a profound truth may be another profound truth. God in Christ, God in you. You know, tuning for. To ring true, a tuning fork has to be held carefully. You can't touch the time of either one, just like this, or the note disappears. Neither time by itself can produce the pure note.
Right.
The tuning fork delivers true pitch only when both times vibrate together.
Right.
That's what God is trying to accomplish in us, so that we're vibrating as he's vibrating.
Yes.
Or we live as he lives.
Yes.
Yes.
And there's a note that goes forth.
Good word.
It's music to the ears of every human on this planet.
Yes.
And it's a cacophony. cacophony and a horrible screech to the devil. But it's beautiful music to us and to those that would be saved. Christ in you, the hope of glory. This treasure in earthen vessels. The kingdom comes by me vibrating in sync with God's vibration, knowing who I am in Christ. Last scripture, 2 Corinthians, again, chapter 4. We'll read verses 6 through 16 to cover it all. 2 Corinthians 4, 6 through 16. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. We have this same treasure in earthen vessels. The knowledge of God in Jesus is the treasure that we have in this earthen vessel. The same thing, God in us. That the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. That's why Jesus always said, the works that I do, they're not mine. It's Father that's in me. He does the works. I only say what I hear my Father say. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about the body, in the body, the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body.
Come on.
For we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. So that death worketh in us, but life in those that we reach out to. We have the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believe, and therefore I have spoken. We also believe, and therefore speak. Knowing that he which raised up the Lord Jesus shall raise up us also by Jesus and shall present us with you. For all things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might through the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of God. For which cause we faint not, but though our outward vessel perishes, yet the inward man, the Spirit of God, is renewed day by day.
Amen.
We carry the treasure of God's revelation to the world. The same as Jesus did.
Yes, we do.
The incarnation is what we're talking about. Christ in you, the hope of glory. This treasure in earthen vessels. As he is in God, so are we. Two profound truths that cannot be denied. They're substantiated throughout the entire Bible.
Amen.
We need to go forward.
Yes.
We need to do what Jesus did.
Yes.
Don't look at the visible.
Right.
Declare the invisible.
Right.
And it manifests. It becomes the reality.
Yeah.
In
Amen.
Jesus' name. Give the Lord a hand clap this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. And you can do it, or God wouldn't have said you can.
Right.
Hallelujah. All the time we spend with kids trying to get them to have high, you know, so their low self-esteem is overcome. This solves all the problems. If we could just get them to Jesus and get the truth into them, they'd be just like Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you, Father. Father, just bless the people as they go. Be with all of us, Lord, until we're able to be together again. Show yourself mighty on our behalf and through us. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You're all dismissed in his matchless name.